Yes, so in the end of the previous class, we have stopped here where I have given the timing with and without page faults. So in the absence of page faults, we can satisfy the process, a part of the process, in like 200 nanoseconds, which is very fast. But with the page fault rate of 0.0001, so with a low rate, I end up with 40 times slower execution for the same part. So here we see that page faults are inevitable, but what we see is page faults are going to decrease our execution time. So we should keep them as few as possible. Also, so to that end, we can apply some tricks because most of the time in this 8 milliseconds part, which is the set of these four steps, page fault overheads, swapping one out and swapping the other in, and restarting this instruction. So these two steps, they involve disk access, and this is the real costly parts, okay, the swapping parts. So if I can reduce the disk access part, these two steps, then even if I keep the same P, the page fault rate, this 8 milliseconds will reduce to like 1 milliseconds or even low. So then the result will automatically improve. So how to reduce the disk interaction? Copy on write is one scheme to that end. So what is that? They are the same. What find yeah, actually copy on write is not about disk writing. So the one with the disk access was another thing. Okay, it was with the dirty bit. So let me first talk about this, and then I will come back to copy on write. So again, my purpose is to reduce the travel to the disk. Okay. So how to do that? I can use this dirty bit or modify bit. So remember, I have a fixed number of frames to play with for a given process. And this is done to prevent overallocation. So to keep fairness, to be fair to all processes, each process gets a fixed amount of pages, frames. Now modify the page fault service routine to include page replacement over those frames. Okay, so what this says is for a given process, I will only access to those fixed frames, like frame 2, 7, 11, and 33, for instance. So those four frames will be used to hold the pages of my process, of the current process. Now the tricky part is the following. Only the modified pages are written back to disk while being removed or replaced. So what do I mean by this? So assume that I talked about four frames, right? For instance, the page in frame 4, I use it, but without writing anything to that memory location. Basically, I make a read-only access. Probably I am reading some information from a big array that is in page 4, okay? That is entirely in page 4. So all the page 4 is about that array, and I just read stuff from that array. So later, I decide to so it was in frame 4, okay? Array is in page 11, but that page 11 is in frame 4 now in the physical memory. Later, I will put this page 11 into disk again, because for the frame 4, I will now load another page, like page 17. Now the thing is, I don't have to rewrite this page 11 to the disk because it hasn't been modified. I just read stuff from it. So when during the page replacement, when I replace the frame 4 with page 17 instead of page 11, I just forget about 11. I don't go to disk and write back. So effectively, I am getting rid of this part, swap page out. So page out means as I move it out, write it to disk. So that out action is gone now. But the in part is inevitable. So you will read the page 17 from disk and write it to frame 7. I think I said 7, right? Okay, frame 7. So this is inevitable, but I can get rid of this cost by just keeping a dirty bit. If the dirty is 0, then it means it hasn't been modified, so I don't do any disk access. But if the dirty bit is 1, so it becomes 1 with even only one little update to that frame, okay? Even if I change only one little memory location, one array, one item of a given big array, I have to write it back to disk in that modified form. Okay, so this is about the usage of a modified bit or dirty bit. Attach a dirty bit to each page in memory. So the unmodified, the clean pages will not be written back to disk, because later, if I want to bring them in, I will use the old version, which is same as the current version. That's why this is important. Yeah, so this is about reducing the disk access. Now let's come back to the copy on write thing. This is also another benefit of virtual memory. This happens with the fork process creation, as we have studied. Fork is used to create a new process. Essentially, what you do is you are a process with a memory space allocated for you. So you have this memory for your process, and at some point you call fork. You create a second process. So basically, you have the copy. So why didn't I just copy this then? You have the copy of this memory logical address space. So it requires a different page, right? So maybe one page is holding this whole process, and here I need a second page. But wait a second. I don't immediately create this new page, because sometimes I do fork, but then I also do exec. Like I replace this memory with a totally different memory. Maybe I am an echo process and I execute a grep. So I am a grep process now. So then I don't really have to create a new page for this existing copied child process, because it will be deleted and it will be replaced with this other process anyway. Okay, so how do I detect these scenarios? I call it copy on write. So if there is an update to this memory space, then I create a new page with the updated content. Otherwise, I use the same page. So let's go deep on this issue. So it will improve your process creation time, right? Because now you don't have to create a new page, you don't have to find a new place for that page, etc. You don't have to write that page to disk, etc. So after fork, child has its own address space that is duplicated from the parent, as we have seen here, which is here. Anyway, child has its own memory whose content is initially same as parent. Yes, okay, we know this. Now, since they are the same, initially we can have the child share the pages of the parent because they are exactly the same. And even if I don't do any exec call, this is still okay because maybe that process will just do only reading for some reason. Okay, so then I can share that page forever because I don't, the child doesn't really update the existing page and the parent is already happy with it. So we can have the child share the pages. And again, the reason is, the motivation is, maybe later the child will do an exec and replace its memory anyway. So then I shouldn't copy this here because it will be replaced with this bigger or smaller new process anyway. No need to copy everything as long as child and parent are just reading those pages. Do copying on write. Copy on write. Do copying when one process, one of the processes do a modification. So it doesn't have to be child. Maybe parent makes a modification, but then child shouldn't be affected by that because child just gets the copy initially. Then it is an independent identity. So yeah, it is the story actually. If one of them, I don't specify which one, but even if one of them makes a modification, only then you make the new page. Here is the visual explanation of that issue. I am the parent. Okay, so I consist of three pages. So I am a small process. And I do a fork, which creates this child with the same size of the logical address space, but obviously the location of this is different in memory. So this is the usual configuration. Actually, not the usual configuration. This is where I talk about the sharing. So when the child creates its own address space, it doesn't add new three pages to the main memory. It just uses the existing three pages already created by the parent, A, B, C. So I point to A, I point to B, I point to C. However, later, process one modifies page C. So this process, parent process, it modifies, it creates the copy of the page just before modification, and now it modifies this copy. So from now on, the third page of process one is this page, which is different than the original page C. And that original page C is still used by process two. Because now whatever I do to this page, process one will not be affected by it. Yeah, so, and this just happened because of the modification here. Without the modification, I can live happily ever after. I can, if I only read page B from left and from right, then I am happy with this configuration because it is the same page anyway. Yeah, so now we talk about the page replacement, which is in the heart of the virtual memory. So we decide smartly which page to replace, because as I mentioned, to prevent over allocation, one process is given a fixed number of frames, like four frames, but it has 14 pages. So those 14 pages will use that four indices, four frames. Obviously, one of them needs to be replaced with the new one, and so on. So find some not in use page in the memory and swap it out. Out means write it to disk. Again, if modified, write it. Otherwise, just remove it out. And then bring the new one instead of in the place of that victim. So which page is the victim? Which page to remove? An algorithm which results in the minimum number of page faults is preferable with one R. Because as I have shown you here, even with one page fault in every 1,000 instruction causes me a 40 times slowdown. So I want to minimize this number. With page replacement, the same page may be brought into memory one or more times, multiple times. Yes, obviously. So assume that I am page 4. So I am brought into frame 1. Later, frame 1 is given to page 11. Okay. And later on, much later, page 4 is brought back now into frame 2 maybe. But eventually the thing is it is brought into the memory. I don't care where it is brought. Maybe into the same frame 1, but maybe into frame 2 or maybe into frame 3 or 4. Remember, I have 4 frames only. Yeah, so it will be brought back multiple times, which is natural. Don't worry about it. And as I have discussed here, when during the swap out part, okay, I write the page back to disk only if it is modified, which is detected by this modify bit, dirty bit. If it is not modified, I don't write it back to disk. I just remove it. And by remove it, I overwrite it with the new page. So the old one is gone. But don't worry, because the same copy of the old one is in the disk anyway. So what is happening here? Let's see replacement with the visual example. I am in page 1. So this is my logical address space. So here, in the 7th instruction of this page 1, okay, whatever, in this program counter is the current instruction being executed in the CPU, and that instruction is making a reference to a memory entity that is living in page M. Okay. However, so that is living in this page. I call this page M. Okay, so this operand that this program counter instruction wants to access is somewhere here. So, okay, it can be here. So it is in page 3. So I go to page table 0123, this entry, to go and get the content from the physical memory where it actually physically lives. But the bad news is this is an invalid bit. So this mapping is invalid, so I don't care what is written here. I will not apply it. So there is a page replace. So this page, there is a page fault. I couldn't find the page. What I have to do is I need to bring this page to the physical memory. To the physical memory in this index, in this frame 4. But it is not shown in this slide, that's why I am confused. But for this process, for this logical space, only 3 frames are allocated to me, okay? And those 3 frames are already holding H and this page I and this page J. It doesn't hold M, so I need to put M instead of in the place of one of these 3 frames, either to 3, 4, or 5. So that is going to happen. So the moral of the story is, it is not a very complicated concept actually. You have a fixed size of frames reserved for the accommodation of your logical space, logical address space, logical memory. And that fixed size is not sufficient. So at some point, you need to replace one of those fixed size frames with a new frame. So you need to decide which frame to update. Okay, this is the idea. Now let's talk about the algorithms. So operating system finds the location of the desired page on disk. This is done by the operating system. So its kernel code is loaded into CPU, and that hardware instruction knows how to talk with the disk, and it locates the desired page on the disk. Okay, so now assume that that page I have access. Now I will write it to a frame. So find the free frame. If there is one, then just use it. Actually, there is no replacement because you already have the frame for you. If there is none, there is no empty frame, then you have alternatives. Use the page replacement policy to select the victim frame. So we will see how to select the victim frame using these four algorithms and maybe even more. And then the victim will be kicked out of that frame. And when I kick it out, if it is modified, then write it to disk. If it is not modified, then do nothing. Okay, because it is not modified. So now the only issue is to understand the replacement policy. Should I use FIFO or second chance or least recently use? So is this the victim? And optimum is just for benchmarking. I can't know the optimum. So it is not an algorithm. I will just show it to compare your result with the optimum result. Bring the desired page into the free frame. And you are still not done because some update needs to be done in the page table, like page 4 is in frame 11 now. So you need to go and update that information to 11. And also the last step is you need to restart that instruction who has caused this page fault, which triggered the page replacement. Okay, so I also have this JavaScript demo on my website. We can go there at some point to play with these algorithms interactively, written by Onur Hoca from METU Ankara. And yeah, so well, let me first talk about them on the slides to grasp the ideas. And then we may go and play with it. And if we don't go, then you go at your own time, play with it. It is again on my website. You know the address. Yeah, so what is happening here? Basic page replacement situation. I have where is one? Huh? One is here. Okay. So I am in my physical memory, and I need to put this page into one of the frames allocated for me. So I select this one as the victim. So maybe it is already empty, so then it is a less emotional choice, but it may also be not empty, then it is just a choice. So I select this. So first step is the victim is written to disk, but there is, I need to again emphasize it, if it has not been modified, i.e. the modify bit is zero, then I don't do step one. I just discard step one. But if it is modified, I do the swap out, write it here. And then the second step is this mapping that moves that page to this frame number is invalid now. So I put a zero here, but I don't care because I will look at this invalid bit anyway. So I will not use this number anyway. So probably this number was 8 or something from the beginning. So it was 8 written here. I made it zero, but more importantly, I set this to I, invalid. Okay, then what happens is I bring the desired page, maybe page 35, into this frame. Okay, so then I go to the page table again. So page 35. Okay, so this is index 35 then here. 0, 1, 2, 3, blah, blah. This is 35. 35 goes to frame 8. Remember, this was 8. So I write 8 to the 35th entry here. Yeah, so it doesn't have to be the previous entry. Okay, it will not be actually the same. Anyway, so these are the actions. So what do you expect, first of all, with the page replacement, without any replacement, what do you expect with the increase in number of frames? If you give me more number of frames to use, me being the process, then the number of page faults will decrease naturally, right? Because I will accommodate more and more pages on memory for me. So I will be more, it will be more likely for me to find a query page because I have already the space. So I probably have them loaded in the main memory. So this is a natural graph then. As the frame number increases, the fault number decreases. And it is not even a linear decrease, as you see. It is decreasing quicker, which is nice. Now let me introduce you the first replacement policy, FIFO, first in, first out. So this is the memory access string. Okay, so I will also use something like this in the exam, by the way. I will tell you the page indices that need to be accessed just as a sequence of integer index IDs. And then I also give you three frames or four frames, whatever, some number of frames. So then you will work on it. So let's work on this together, actually, with a pen. So when one comes, I already have three frames. So I put one here. Then two comes, I put two here. Then three comes, I put it. So I select this because this is already free. It was not an emotional choice again. Then I make my program. So currently, one of these three pages are executing in the CPU. So maybe the second page, page two, has reached an instruction here in the middle of it. And that instruction makes a memory access to an array, for instance, and to a weird index of an array. So that index is at a very far away location. So it is that item indexed by that index is at a far away location. In particular, it is in page 4. So I find that page 4 in disk. I bring it to memory, but where to memory? I have only three places available. So according to the FIFO policy, I remove the oldest one, because first in means you have been born first, so you are the oldest one. It is a reasonable choice. It looks that way at least. So I victim is this. I put 4 here. So I just write it to the right of it, but actually 4 is here, inside here. Now, and by the way, let's also count the page fault. So this is the first page fault. So I put an X here, because a page fault has happened due to the 4. Now, the second reference is to page 1, which is not in the in one of the existing frames, right? 4, 2, 3 are here. So another page fault. And also in the exam, you will count your faults. So you should somehow stick with this framework. Okay, so 1 is a page fault, 2 page faults. So what will I do with 1? First in, first out, so I will touch this one because out of 4, 2, 3, this was the oldest. So this is replaced by 1 now. Then comes another access to page 2, which was just replaced. So It is not good actually. So another pitfall, third one. So I bring it back and I put it here because this is the oldest compared to 1, 4, 1, and 3. 3 was the oldest. So I put 2 here. Now comes 5. It is a totally new page. I haven't seen it before, so there is nothing I can do. I have to get it. So another page fault because 5 isn't in my set, which is currently 1, 4, 2. Another fault, X. And I replaced the oldest of 4, 1, 2, which is 4. So this becomes 5 now. Okay. Then I have an access to 1, which is inside my frame. So wonderful. There is no page fault here. Okay. Which is a good news. I will use it. I will go to frame 2 to use page 1. Okay. Page 1 will be used by going to frame 2. Okay. Nothing is replaced. So no replacement algorithm. Replacement algorithm is doing nothing here because 1 is already found. No page fault. Remember, if there is a page fault, then replacement policy is in action. Okay, then 2. 1 is done. 2. Still, I can find 2. It is in frame 3. No page fault. Continuing. Now 3. I have 5, 1, 2. So there is a page fault, unfortunately. X is coming here. Okay, so 3. Which of them should I kill? I most recently added 5. So this was the oldest one. This is gone. And this becomes 3. And then 4 comes. 5, 3, 2. So I handle 4, but there is a page fault because 4 isn't around. So I will replace this because 5, 3 is the youngest. 5 is the second youngest. This one was the oldest, so I replace it with 4. And then comes 5, which is already here. So there is no page fault. So the number of page fault is 9, not 6, unlike here. But don't panic because I forgot to put access on these 3. Initially, when I have 3 empty frames, everything is empty. So everything is a miss because I just start the execution. I naturally couldn't find 1. So there is a page fault, X, and I put 1 here. Then I couldn't find 2, another fault, put 2 here. Then couldn't find 3 and put 3 here. And then continue as before. So, okay, this is... So you will do something similar in the exam, okay, with different policies, but you should understand this logic. But the reason I am showing this example is actually twofold. There are 2 reasons. This one reason is to understand this mechanism, and the second one is FIFO is not a good strategy because when I increase the number of frames, I expect the page faults to decrease, right? But there is some anomaly happening here. The abnormal thing is I have more page faults now, 10 page faults instead of 9, even if I have given more places to work with. So this is called an anomaly, namely Belady's anomaly. More frames leads to more page faults. This can't happen with an optimal algorithm, but with the FIFO algorithm, it can happen. With the FIFO algorithm, it can happen. And better policies will prevent this anyway, like least recently used or second chance policies. Just to be sure about these 10 faults, let's make it very quick. So even initially 1, 2, 3, 4, they all cause a fault. Okay. So instead of X, I will just put this line, 4 faults. Then 1, I find it, right? So no fault. Then for two, I find it no fault. Actually, it is going good. Now there is a problem. Be careful. When five comes, there is a page fault. So fault, and I will replace this with five. And now the rest, I will use a sorted order. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. So it will be a problem because 4, 1, I will replace this, and now 2 is gone. But when 2 is seen here, I will replace 3, but then 3 is requested, and so on. So all of them will cause a page fault. Effectively, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 faults. Okay. So this basic strategy comes with such anomalies, abnormal activities. We should consider something different then. Here, actually, this is a typical scenario with number of frames increased. Actually, it's not a typical scenario. Sorry, this is about this example. Because when frames is 3, result is 9. And when it is 4, it is 10. So 3, 9, and 4, 10. So if you do it for other frame numbers with the same sequence, you can practice this on your own. You will have this behavior. So the behavior here, actually, this is also not very good. I am increasing the number of frames, but I am not decreasing the faults. Okay. So FIFO is not a very good strategy then. Here is the optimal algorithm. Let's study this. So this is the best you can do here is with 6 page faults apparently. So let's go there. So this algorithm provides the minimum number of page faults. FIFO can't do it and all others can't do it. But how it works is it requires some future guessing, like future telling, like some mystical activities. That's why we can't really implement this. We can predict the future by running the same program multiple times. We can detect a pattern, or actually we can keep a profile. So we can get close to this optimal algorithm, but naively we cannot implement this. Okay, so let's go with this algorithm. 1 page fault put here, 2 page fault put here, 3 and 4. So 4 is also a page fault. Put this here. So I already have 4 page faults, which is inevitable because I have to fill my 4 frames anyway, right? So these are the faulty guys. Okay. Now, for the next choice, actually 1 is not an issue because 1 is already here. 2 is already here, no problem. Now I need to trigger the replacement algorithm because there is a page fault. So what is it that I will do? So I look at the future. So this is the future guessing part. So apparently in the future, I will access to 1, 2, 3 already. And I already have 4 spaces. So I should then get rid of 4 because I will serve these 3 in the near future. I need to serve 4 at some point. But I don't care because I look at the next 3 steps in front of me. So I decide to kill 4. Okay. So this is kind of a last in first out choice, right? So it doesn't come to mind naturally. But yeah, given this prediction or future observation, I will kill 4. So I write 5 here. Okay. 5 is written here. So remember to put your page fault mark here. Then thanks to this choice, this wonderful choice, this optimal choice, no fault here. 1 is seen, 2 is found, 3 is found, no fault. Later, an inevitable fault comes because after all, you have a small amount of frames to deal with, to play with, to use. So this 4, there will be a fault, page fault, the sixth page fault is this x put an x here. Now trigger the replacement algorithm because there is a fault. What am I going to do? Actually, nothing to trigger. I look at the feature and I see that there is only one item. So preserving this is enough for me because in the future I will access here. So the only bad choice is to replace the frame 4. And I avoid that choice. I can put it anywhere here, 1, 2, 3. Just put it to the first place. Okay, so I replace 1 and I put 4 here. So currently my frames are holding page 4, page 2, page 3, and page 5. As you see here. And I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 faults, which is the optimal algorithm. Here is a different scenario of this algorithm in action. And then I will also go to the other algorithms, but let's give another break because we already hit the 40 minutes limit. Okay, so I will see you in 14:40. So let's finish the page replacement policies. We have already dealt with the FIFO policy, first and first start. We have started with the optimal algorithm, optimal policy, which is not practical because it requires some feature guessing. It involves that you can predict the feature by some profiling based on the previous executions of the same process or similar processes, or even do some kind of machine learning to get that done. But still, this is not going to be 100% reliable prediction. That's why this algorithm cannot be implemented in the naive way. We use this algorithm to compare the other practical algorithms with. So we actually eventually want to reach the quality of this algorithm. So the closer we are to this algorithm, the better we are. So in this case, what is happening is this is your reference string. These are the page numbers that I need to access, and I have only 3 frames available. So I have a page fault in the first demand because initially frames are empty, although not shown here. Then for 0, I have another fault and bring it to this victim frame, which is the empty frame. Then I have a third fault and I select this as my victim and I keep it, put it here. Now, page two is the first time I access it. So naturally I have a page fault. I can't find 2 because I haven't even used it before. So here is my page fault notification. Now the next task is to decide which of these 3 to kill, 7, 0, or 1. So I look at the feature, I see 0, so definitely keep it. Then will I see 7 or 1 first? So the one I see first will survive. So yeah, I see 1 eventually. So it means that I will not be accessing 7 earlier than the other selections, 0 and 1. That's why I kill 7, so I put 2 here. Now this is the current configuration, 201. And there is no fault here because 0 is already here. For 3, there is a page fault because I have 301, but I don't have 3. So here is my fault notifier. So which one should I kill, 2, 0, or 1? So I will see 0 in near future, don't touch it. I will see 2 in near future, don't touch it. So the only option is 1. So I will kill 1. Replace it, so put 3 here. So for 0, I don't have a page fault because it was here. For page 4, I have a page fault because currently I have 2, 0, and 3. Here is my page fault notifier. Then which one is the victim? I will access 2, 3, and 0. I already have 2, 3, and 0. But the first two I will keep them alive, so I will get rid of zero. So I put four here. And as expected, I don't have a fault in two because I already saved it with this optimal choice. With three, I am good. I am here. With zero, unfortunately, I need to do a page replacement because zero isn't involved in this tree. So which one should I kill? Two, four, or three? Two is here. Actually, three is also very in near future. So I need to kill four because I won't access it anyway, at least in the near future. So four is replaced by zero. This is the current configuration. Three, no fault, use it here. For page two, go to frame zero. For page one, I can't go anywhere because one isn't here. So select a victim out of two, zero, and three. I will go with three, I guess. Why? Because two will be accessed and zero is also. So I will definitely keep them in my life. And I will remove three. So instead of three, I put one. And then request two is demanded. Remember, we are doing demand paging. No fault. Zero is demanded, no fault. One is demanded, no fault. Seven is demanded, there is a fault. Here is my fault notifier. And in the near future, I will access zero and one. So I will better keep them and I will replace two. So seven is here then. And zero, no fault, one, no fault. So the number of faults I have experienced is 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. You cannot do better than 9, okay? This is the best because you have a very limited amount of frames. So is there any way can you do it with zero page fault? Let's think about it. Assume that I gave you, so how many accesses are here? Like I give you 1000 frames, okay? Still you cannot do zero faults because in the beginning you have to bring them whenever you see them first, okay? So actually the minimum number of page faults is the number of distinct accesses. So in this case, I have zeros, ones, twos, threes, four, no, five, six. So I have six different elements, right? One, two, three, four, five, and six is the seven. Yeah, I have six. So I will definitely experience at least six page faults. Even if I give you all the frames in the world, in my computer, also in my neighbor's computer, you will definitely experience six page faults. So you will trigger page replacement six times. In this example, I have experienced nine page faults and I said that this is optimal. So what happened to six then? But the problem is nine is optimal given that you have only three frames at your disposal. This six is available if you have a lot of frames at your disposal. Actually, you have six frames at least. Yeah. Okay, now let's go practical and talk about a practical algorithm that you can implement without requiring any mystical information from future. So this algorithm is called LRU, least recently used is the victim, which makes sense, right? Because the most recently used page is likely to be used again. So because a page comes with 4,000 instructions in it, so you are in instruction 2021, probably most likely you will next execute instruction 2022. So you should then better keep that page alive. So this is the motivation. Victim page is the one. So since you will keep the most recently used alive, the natural option is to kill the least recently used page. And this is used heavily in practice. So this is a very common policy, better than FIFO. Let's see how many page faults I will experience with 4 frames. And I have 4, 6, 8, 12 different, not different, but 12 references to pages. So initially 1, no, so bring it. 2, bring it. 3, bring it. And 4, bring it. And you put them into your 4 frames after 4 page faults. Now 1 comes, it is in my set, so don't bother, no fault. 2, no fault. Then comes a weird number that I can't read. 5, I guess, based on here. Yeah, so this is 5. Okay, so 5 doesn't exist. I need, so there is a page fault. Here is my X for that. So which of 1, 2, 3, and 4 I should remove? I have most recently used 2, so better keep it. Then I have used 1, better keep it. Then I have used 4, better keep it. So 3 happens to be the least recently used, the oldest one. So I haven't used 3 after this point. But yeah, and this is a very far away from point from where I am currently at. So I use 3 as my victim, put 5 here. So this is the current configuration, 1, 2, 5, 4. Continue, no fault, no fault because 2 is here. 3 is a fault, so here is my X. I recently accessed 2, so I am more likely going to access it again. Actually, it has happened here. So 1, 2, again 1, 2. So maybe I am in a for loop or something here. So I am repeating something. So pattern repeats. So I keep 2, 1, 5 alive. 2 also alive because 2 was used here. So this doesn't affect me. 1 is also here. It was used here. Not affects me. 4. So 4 is the least recently used one. Then I remove 4 and put 3 here. So currently I have 1, 2, 5, 3. Now, unfortunately, 4 is requested. So something strange happened. Although 4 is accessed a long time ago, I assumed that I am done with 4. So it is in my past as a memory, not a virtual memory, but an emotional memory. So I thought that I will not talk with him or her again, but then life happens and suddenly you interact with her again. So this is unexpected, but it can happen. So that's why this is not optimal, as you can see. Although 4 seems to be a reasonable choice, in the next step I unfortunately access 4. So inevitable, there is a miss, there is a page fault. And now for the 4, which one should I kill? So definitely keep 3 alive because I just interacted with it. Likely to talk with him again. 2 recent, let it stay. 1 recent, let it stay. And then, so where is my configuration? Yeah. Yeah, okay. 1 let it stay. Now 5 is the next. I am going from right to left. Yeah, 5 is. Should go because 3, 2, 1 are already close enough. 5 is the most separated one. So 5 is replaced by 4. Now comes a brand new page. So there is nothing you can do about it. Even the optimal algorithm will do a replacement for this. Okay. Because there will be a page fault and. If there is no empty place, like if you are not in the beginnings, you will definitely do a replacement. So which one to replace to put 6 in? four, let it stay because I apparently have a weird relationship with four. It can come anytime. So keep her active around. Four, three, keep active. Two, keep active. One is history. So intuition is that I am done with one. I will not demand any service from that old entity again. So one is replaced by six. How many faults occurred? Two, four, six, eight. Eight, yes, as suggested here. Okay. Here is a quiz question, not an official quiz, but something to think about. When does LRU reduce to FIFO? Okay, can you think about that for a while? So least recently used policy becomes FIFO policy. I am also thinking. So if you find anything, let me know.
Maybe if there is no loop.
What?
If there is no loop.
Sorry, I couldn't hear. It has no one?
If there is no loop.
There is no loop. There is no loop. yeah, so you mean that once... So all your accesses are new elements, for instance, new pages, and they go in sorted order, actually not necessarily sorted order, in any order. So you don't go to a previous one, then yes, you are correct. You have your FIFO because, so assume that you have numbers from 1 to 10 in sorted order for simplicity. 1, 2, 3, 4, and you have four frames. 1, 2, 3, 4. Then, to accommodate five, you will remove one, which is the least recently used. It is also the first one, FIFO, right? So for five, I remove one. Then six, for six, I remove two, because it is the least recently used one, and also effectively, it is the first in, because there is no loop. Yeah. Correct, thanks. Okay, so what are happening? Let's see other algorithms. Actually, not other algorithms. How to implement LRU? So I need some kind of a helper variable, right? Like telling me the time or something. So I can implement it using a counter. Every page entry, like 7 or 1 or 2 or 0. These are page entries. Let's think it that way. With them, I keep a second information. Every page entry has a counter. Every time page is referenced, copy the clock or not the official CPU clock value or the word clock time. You can just keep a value that is monotonically increasing, okay? With every processing, it increases. So every time page is referenced, copy the clock or the increasing value to the counter value that you associate with that page. When replacement needed, pick the one with the minimum counter value or clock value, because it will be just recently used. So it is, again, not going to be FIFO, the first use, because I undo it. Whenever I use it again, it will be undone. That's why this is going to solve the LRU problem only. But actually, instead of keeping the CPU clock, which requires an additional clock access, I will think about something else. And also increasing this value is also, it means keeping another value. So to implement this, we will use stack. Okay, but not the usual stack. it will be more like a double-ended queue. Okay, so call it whatever you want, double stack, D stack. Move the reference page to the top. Okay, so for instance, what is happening here is in this version, let's analyze it over an example. Move the reference page to the top. When replacement needed, pick the one from the bottom. So this is not with the stack logic, but thanks to the double-ended notion, I can get the bottom entry. So let me be clear. So four is referenced, put it here. So assume that no one on top of four. Then seven, then zero. Now be careful. Seven is referenced, so I don't see all the steps, but I move it to top. So now 7 is here and 0 is here. Then 1 comes, right? Yeah, 1 is here. Then 0 comes. So it is referenced, move it to the top. Okay, so 0 here. You basically swap them, okay? Put 1 here. It is the fastest way to do this moving to top action. Then 1 is seen again, referenced. So move it to the top. So 0 swaps, 1 goes up. Then 2 comes. Actually, 2 is already not existing, so put it here. Notice that I don't have any duplicates here. So 2 is on top here. So 2, 1, 7, 0, 4. Then where am I? I am here, I guess. 2, I handled 2. So I reference to 1. So 1 is here. And 2 is below. I swap them. Okay, then I am here, 2 comes, I think, okay, so we came to the slide point, 2 comes, so 2 above, let me write it here, and 1 below, and we have 7, 0, and 4. Now, when you see a 7, it goes to top, and 2 comes here. Yeah, so maybe in this implementation, they are not swapping it. They are just moving 2 one step down, okay? So you are like shifting it. So this puts 7 down top and shifts the others back. So I have shown you a different strategy, which is also not perfect, fine. But apparently this slide, when you put something to top, you just shift the others back until this empty slot. So it will be 7, 2 and 1. They go one step down. So I end up with this configuration. Yeah, so this is the structure I am using. Move the reference page to the top. Okay, so at some point, so currently no replacement has been needed because I already have 5 slots, 5 frames, and I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different values to play with. So I can handle them without any replacement. So sometimes here, because those 5 will already be here, no problem. Later, maybe if I request page 8, then I need to do a replacement. So what you need to do is then pick the one from the bottom. So, and it effectively implements the LRU logic because 7 is not touched. I touch 4, which is, as you see in this example, it has not been accessed for a long while. Actually, it is the least recently used one, which is definitely waiting you in the end of the stack, bottom of the stack. Yeah, so with this implementation, What is the problem then? There is still, this is not the optimal solution. With every memory reference, you make more references to set up the pointers of the stack, right? So after all, I am maintaining some pointers here, bottom, front, and also some shifting is also happening. So this is a solution, but not a fast solution. Again, the counter-based solution requires hardware access, which is like loading the kernel code to the CPU and getting that hardware specific information. So another time consuming stuff. Then I decide the following. Both counter and stack implementations are exact LRU solutions. So we are good in that department. However, they are inefficient. I can make LRU approximations, so not the exact solution, but with a very fast solution. So I don't spend additional overhead time with like I do with these two other exact approaches. So let's go with an approximation approach where I do the following. With each page, associate a bit, which is zero initially. It implies not used, not referenced. So by the way, where can you store it? For every page, you already have a page table which stores the corresponding frame ID. So after all, you have that location. Why not just store another ID, which is the reference ID? It is a bit. It is not even as big as the frame number, because frame number is a 32-bit information, 1 byte integer, but this is just a 1 bit information, 0 or 1. So it doesn't really hurt me to store this in the page table. When the page is referenced, bit set to 0. Bit is set to 0. Reference bit is set to 0. Let's be exact. Okay, so this is for the access time. Reference time, and for the replacement time, that time will come at some point, use the one which has zero reference bit. So it means that it kind of hasn't been referenced for a while. So I don't really know the while, that's why this is an approximation algorithm, but I will use this tactic. There may be multiple zeros, by the way, right? So one page. Page 4 hasn't been accessed. Also, page 8 hasn't been accessed. So I have 2 zeros already. We only know those 0 pages are not referenced during the last clock interval. So reference bits are cleared periodically with every clock interrupt. This is also related to the algorithm. So let's understand this over an example. So this approximation algorithm is also known as second chance algorithm, okay? It is more of a combination of FIFO and the reference bit algorithm. So it goes like this. Initially, all reference bits are 1. To r equal to 1 pages, give a second chance by making r equal to 0 and moving them to the tail. Reasonably close, because r equal to 1 means recently used. So if I have referenced here, okay, then it already has 1 and 1. Then then what happens is when I make r equal to 0, remember I will select the victims from r equal to 0 set, but I will also move them to the end. So I am kind of giving them a second chance. So it will be more clear with nothing. If I don't have a specific example for that, do I? Yeah, apparently not. Second chance. So I, okay. I will. So this is, there is only one simple example here, which is not sufficient. So I will then leave this to the other lecture to go over this algorithm one more time, because at this version, it doesn't really explain a lot. So we are already running out of time. So let me just finish finish this stuff. So this is also something handled. I just found a problem from web, and it is solving this victim selection problem using LRU and FIFO policies and optimal policies. We have discussed these three policies in detail anyway. So I expect you to solve this. Actually, this is a very involved question. You solve it with different numbers of frames. So here, maybe the only interesting part, not the only interesting, but the simplest part is here. If you use seven frames and you have seven different pages anyway, then the only page faults you will need is for the initial load of that distinct frame. Okay, so you will load one only once, then two, then three, then four. Then for two, you don't load it because you already have it and you haven't removed it during the insertion of four or something, because I already have a place for four. So with that logic, five, six, they don't cause any preemption. They don't cause any replacement. And seven is also no problem. So this is the simplest column here. You can just put sevens here. For the others, these are also easy, but requires some pen and pencil work. That's why I am avoiding it here now. Yeah, so what else to talk about? Keep a counter of the number of references made to each page. Keep a counter. Okay, now I am changing least recently used to least frequently used. Okay, so a little update, be careful, notice that in LFU, remember we have studied LRU, so this is LFU. Least frequently used, replace the page with the smallest count, where the count keeps the number of references made to each page. So motivation is the following. Apparently I have used that page. Maybe it is representing the end of my program, like a small portion. So it is not a very popular page, so I can replace it. How about the MFU? Should I use the most frequently referenced page to remove? Yeah, it may make sense sometimes. So the argument is the page with the smallest count was probably just brought in and has yet to be used. So you are not maybe happy with the LFU. So this is the argument is as follows. So maybe I just brought page 7 to the system, to the frame 20. And now I need to bring page 100 to the frames, and I have only 20 frames, so I need a replacement. But I don't want to replace the 7, because it is unfortunately the least frequently accessed one, but it is because it is the youngest one. I just brought it, so it is natural for that page to be very inactive. That's why you can go with the MFU. So M means most frequently used. So it is likely that I have used that page a lot. Maybe it was corresponding to a for loop. And now I am done with that for loop. So maybe I will never go back to that function where I call that for loop. So I can remove most frequently used one as well. So this is also a nice heuristic then, just like the other one. So there is no perfect answer here, actually. Yeah. So I guess this is a good point to stop, because so far we learned which page to remove in case of a page fault. And now, and by now I mean next week. So now, if you remove the O in the middle, it becomes next week. Next week, we will learn how many frames should we allocate to a process. So this is also an interesting question. Should I always allocate five fixed number of five frames to the same process, or to each process in my system, or should I allocate it based on its size or something? So there are some important design decisions here taken by the operating system. So we will go over them in our next class, where we will talk the last words on memory management. That's why I will stop here. Yes.